Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning and the old cookbook show. Today's recipe sort of came to me as a bit of a mystery. I started seeing people leaving comments in my comment section about, have you seen Cronk? And I thought, what's Cronk? So I looked it up and I came across a Twitter find. A researcher at the University of Calgary had been looking through old newspapers, as you do, and came across advertisements for something called Cronk. They were just Cronk, drink Cronk, Cronk is good, Cronk is great. No sort of information about what Cronk was. Power of the internet. People start searching for Cronk, and within a very short time period, someone had come up with a cookbook that featured Dr. Cronk's sarsaparilla beer. And the cookbook is called The Handbook of Practical Receipts or Useful Hints in Everyday Life. And apparently it's a sarsaparilla beer. And the information about it is pretty hazy. There's lots of advertisements across Canada and the United States. Turns out Dr. Cronk sold the recipe to franchisees, essentially, so that they could make it in their town or city. And the recipe in this book is very vague, so I'm going to do my best to follow it exactly, but some of the ingredients aren't... You don't really know what they are. So for the first part of the recipe, I'm going to take chamomile, cinnamon, ginger, sassafras, sarsaparilla, and hops. Now it doesn't tell me which hops to use, it just says hops. So I'm thinking this is 1830s, mid-1800s. They would be the classic European hops. So I'm going to put in a combination, or I put in a combination of UK Fuggle, German Tettnang, and German Hallertau. I think that should give sort of that classic European flavor that was probably in vogue at that time. Also tells me to put in sarsaparilla extract. So I've got some sarsaparilla extract here. This is all from the root beer. This is essentially just a take on the root beer recipes that we did and the sarsaparilla recipes that we did last year, kind of mixed with a bitterness from the hops that would lend itself more to beer, and also the ginger, which will give it sort of, I'm thinking, a ginger ale-y type flavor. Now it says to boil this for 2 hours. It doesn't say how much water to put in. So I'm assuming I need to put in enough water to cover and enough water so that it doesn't boil away over the 2 hour cook. I'm gonna say about that much. So that was just about a liter of water I put in there. I'm going to bring this up to a boil and I'm gonna let it boil for 2 hours. This has boiled for 2 hours now. And at the end of the first hour, so much water had evaporated because I hadn't put a lid on it, that I needed to add extra water to it because it had almost evaporated completely. So I put more water in and then I put the lid on. You need to boil hops in order to extract the acids that contribute the bitterness. And depending on how long you boil them, there's a certain amount of extraction and blah, 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 blah. That's all beer making stuff. And I don't know how much of that is important in this particular instance. But you are looking for a thorough extraction of all of the flavors from the barks, the ginger, the hops, everything that's in there. So the 2 hours is good. Maybe put a cover on it to limit the amount of evaporation you have. Now I need to strain it. And I've got a big strainer here with a coffee filter in it. And I've wet the coffee filter down to get it ready. I'm going to filter it first through another fine mesh strainer so that we don't gum up the coffee filter completely. Let's see if we can do this without spilling. I'm going to let this filter through and cool down to room temperature before we move on to the next step. I also have some green tea that's steeping here. That's part of the next step. And I'm going to get ready the fermentor, the water, and the molasses. And we'll combine everything with the yeast. Final assembly. Now, the original recipe calls for 100 gallons of water. I'm obviously making a much smaller amount. I'm all in, but I'm not 100 gallons all in. So, molasses is the sugar that drives the fermentation. This is a fermented drink. So I'm going to put that into the carboy. It's pretty warm here today. It pours nicely. And I'll give it a shake to mix it up. Now, there's foam on top of the water. That is from something called star sand. And star sand is essentially a disinfectant that you use in brewing, and it foams. And you're not supposed to rinse away the foam. You're just supposed to leave it. So don't worry about the foam. Next in, this is the tisane of all of the parts that we boiled up earlier. So in that goes. And let me tell you, it does not smell great. A little bit of sludge. This is the green tea. Okay, and we'll give this a swirl just to completely mix it up. Now, I am going to take a reading of the sugar amount before I put the yeast in so that at the end I can do another test and see how much alcohol we produced. Based on the amount of yeast that they want me to put in and the amount of sugar, I'm kind of expecting that this will be somewhere between 4 and 5% alcohol. So, I'm just going to take off a little bit to test. Little taste. And the yeast. It just said to put in yeast, to pitch yeast. And I have to imagine that they were using brewer's yeast, standard probably ale yeast in the 1830s. I don't know which specific type of yeast they were asking for because it doesn't say. So I'm going to use Safrole US05. And this is a yeast that is something that gives a fairly clean brew, produces alcohol fairly well, and doesn't add a lot of its own taste. So I'm just going to pitch that on top. And you can already see it dissolving into the liquid. We should get a pretty good brew off of this. Next, I'm going to take a little bit of sample. And I'm using a digital refractometer to do this test. And for those of you who brew beer at home and use an analog refractometer that you hold up to your eye, this does essentially the same thing, except completely differently. And it's very accurate. So while that's doing the testing, I've got an airlock. And I'll put the airlock on. This will go into the basement, probably around 65 degrees Fahrenheit for about a week as it ferments. Okay, so on the nose, all I get is molasses. That molasses will go away during fermentation as the yeast eats the sugar. I expect some of it to stay, but not a lot. That's quite nice. That is quite nice. I think after it's fermented and carbonated, that'll be pretty good. So I'll see you back here in a week. Okay, here we are 8 days later. The Cronk has been bubbling away in the basement in the brewery. The fermentation stopped probably towards the end of day 5. I left it for a few extra days because it doesn't hurt. Just to make sure that the fermentation was completely done, I wasn't exactly sure where it was going to end. So I thought, let's be safe. Now I'm going to transfer this to a little corny keg and we are going to force carbonate it. So everything is cleaned and sanitized at this point. All of the transfer stuff is in the sanitizer and I just sprayed down the outside of the carboy with some sanitizer to make sure that everything is clean. You don't want to get any nasties in your keg. So let's do the transfer. Now, this is something I normally do down in the brewery because you're going to get liquid everywhere. Okay, so siphon is siphoning. Okay, so I'll transfer it over, put the lid on the keg, spray down the top with a little bit more sanitizer. And fill it with gas. Typically, I purge the CO2 a couple of times. I'm actually purging the oxygen that's left in the tank and filling it with CO2. It just keeps it for a little bit longer. I'm filling this right now to 30 psi. I'm going to move the keg into our keg fridge for 3 or 4 days to carbonate under 15 psi. And then we'll come back and give it a taste. Okay.
It's time.
Spilling Cronk.
What? How could you waste it? That's a little bit too foamy, perhaps.
So it is overcarbonated.
A little overcarbonated. We might need to wait.
There we go. Oh, second one. So the
second
line.
Second pour is always better.
The line was just, there you go. I'll get another glass.
All right.
The line was just overcharged. Maybe not cold enough.
So it doesn't smell like it did before. Like when you boiled it up, it had all the, it still has a strong molasses smell to it.
The color's really nice. It's got a great head.
It's even like a nice yellowy kind of color to it.
Okay. So for the first time in probably 150 years, someone's tasting Cronk.
Cronk! Drink it.
Cronk is the drink.
Yep. And just as a note, a fundraiser from our friends in Calgary for the Alex Community Food Center.
Alex Community Food Center. So one of our viewers in Calgary saw that we were making Cronk, and Cronk is a big deal in Calgary. So he sent us this t-shirt, and they're doing a fundraiser.
So that's got a bite to it. It is.
Okay, so it's a little bit weird.
Yeah, it's not super sweet, even though it tastes like, even though you can taste the molasses, there's a hint of molasses to it, it's not super sweet.
So I'm getting molasses mostly on the nose right at the beginning.
Yeah.
But I'm not getting too much of a flavor of molasses.
No.
This clocked in at 2.9% alcohol, so just under 3%, which is about right, because in all the advertisements for this in the 1830s, 1860s, it said that it was a temperance drink. And at that time, even though it's 2.9% alcohol, at that time, this would have been considered a temperance drink because it wasn't whiskey at, you know, 65%.
So, I wouldn't define it as being crushable.
No, it's not crushable.
It's not crushable, which means that it's not an easy, light, no flavor kind of, you just drink it back because it's cold.
You couldn't suck this back on a patio all afternoon. So it's not a session beer either. It's not overly bitter. So the hops are just sort of there just a little bit.
It is refreshing, though.
It is refreshing, yeah.
Like, it is, you know, you'd like, oh, no, okay, I'm good. I can see how people would be like, yeah, I'm good, I'm ready to go. I don't know what that means, but, you know.
It's weird, because in all of the advertisements in the 1800s, it was listed as a health drink, as a temperance drink, as something that you got at the pharmacy, or you got at a tavern, and it doesn't quite fall into anything. So I don't get any of the ginger that was put in here. I don't actually taste it as a sarsaparilla or a root beer.
If you're trying, no, it is not a root beer.
No. So if you're thinking, oh, it's like an A&W root beer or a Sioux City sarsaparilla, because it's got none of that in it, none of that at all,
and
not in this
recipe.
No. And that's the thing. Is this the definitive Cronk recipe? Is there still a Cronk recipe?
And to so we've got, you know, a gallon of Cronk to drink before we attempt something else. And by the time that happens, perhaps the other brewers that are out there trying to do this will have a different recipe and will have tried something different.
So there's a commercial brewery in Calgary that is right now, as we speak, it's probably in their fermenter.
And
They're doing at least 100 gallons based on this same recipe. And I'd be interested to find out how theirs differs. So, Cronk is the drink. Thanks for stopping by. Stay safe. See you again soon.
And yet somehow I drank most of mine.
Well, yeah, and I think it's going to go really well with the Montreal smoked meat that's on the burner here.
Yes, it will.